Thank you, folks, for those who stayed. Next on the agenda is our pay and class study presentation. Matt Reese from the Regional Council.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate you all giving us some time on your agenda.
Hey,
Ms.
Matt.
Massey, thank you so much for being our delegate. Commissioners, thank you all for your support of the Regional Council. So I do not have PowerPoint. I do not have folks have accompanied me this morning, so that means I just need to keep it brief, right? So I will do my best
with
that. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Mission understood. Before you, you have a proposal to do a classification and pay study, and that is a study of work in the organization. So that's the first thing to sort of hold on to. This is not a study of individuals. This is not a study of employees. But we're trying to come in and capture what's the organizational dynamic, how is it designed, how do you have departments organized, how do those departments have individual positions organized, and what's the work of those positions. The idea is to compare that with what's going on internally with other departments, as well as compare what's going on externally in other organizations. The idea with this is to have an assessment. It's routine maintenance, if you will, of your human resources system. The idea is to make sure that the classification system is appropriate, the kinds of jobs that you've established, how you've characterized those jobs in terms of the standards that they have is up to date and accurate, and come back and provide you with some market data about where those positions would be placed. The way we approach the work is fairly deliberate, that we ask all of the employees to participate in a questionnaire or complete one individually. Those questionnaires are submitted to their supervisors. Their supervisors review those and check off to be sure that they're accurate. It provides very detailed information in terms of what are the kinds of working conditions that they're subject to, what are the kinds of decisions that they make, what's the scope and depth of their work, what kinds of knowledge, skills, and abilities are needed to complete the job. What kinds of consequence of error do they have? If they make a mistake in their job, what sort of liability does that have back on Alamance County? What kind of supervision they receive, and if they're supervisors, how broad is the supervision that they have to give? And those are the classification factors that we look at when we're trying to assess those positions. So the intent of all that is to come up with an apples-to-apples comparison of what's the work going on in Alamance to what's the work going on in similar jurisdictions of size and scope and positions, and come back and provide that information to the county and say, here's what the assessment is, here's the update to that vertical structure that you have of assignment of classes to grades. That's the ultimate expression of the study, is that range that we have that would start somewhere at grade 50 and go on up to grade 70s. That is the product from the study. We will have classification specs that will be updated. The product that is probably most important is to have all of the employees complete this questionnaire, because that's primary data where they sign off on the questionnaire saying this is my job, their supervisor signs off on that job, and that's an excellent resource to have on down the road. So we would hope to engage in this project in about another 30 days or so, get started with orientations for employees, have those set. Be looking at bringing information back to the county manager around February, March for inclusion in the budget process for the following fiscal year, and have those ready for you to consider at that point in time. I tried to be brief with that.
You did well.
Matt, do we have a meeting tomorrow?
Yes, ma'am. I think we do.
I think we do. I gotcha.
First day back. You're going to have to get me in the office.
I've been keeping up there.
Thank you.
And Mr. Chairman, as you know, when I first got on this board, this was one of my main agenda items. I think it's extremely important. When I was on the mental health board and chairman of that board, it was required by state law that we have these assessments periodically. I would like to move that we approve this assessment and classification study.
I'd like to ask one more one question. I may have overlooked it, or you may have said it.
Let me get a second here. Is there a second?
Okay.
John,
second.
Right, go ahead, Tim. Sorry.
Well, you might not want a second after you get an answer from my question, so you know.
Well,
I don't know that was fair. No, I support it too. But what counties are you using for comparisons here?
We'll be looking at the immediate Piedmont Triad, and certainly looking at counties of similar size like Randolph and Rockingham and Davidson and so forth. So we'll try to get a mix. Obviously, you've got Guilford on one side and Orange on the other, so we'll need to include those. But Chatham, Randolph, Rockingham, those folks as well. Davidson.
Yeah.
Any other questions for Mr. Reese?
Mr. Chair, I do want to say that the total cost on this is $50,000, but we did budget $60,000 on this, so it did come in less than we originally thought.
Okay. Any more questions? Motion's been made and seconded. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you. Motion passes unanimously. Next on the agenda, we'll hear from Social Services. Susan?
Actually, Linda and Adrian are going to...
All right.
We've been briefing you this morning.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. I'm Linda Allison, Deputy Director at DSS, and I have with me Adrian Day. She's our Assistant Director of Services. Thank you so much for this opportunity to come today and talk about some of the services that we offer. I know we'll keep it very brief. Basically, what we want to discuss today is that our role has changed in the community with regard to this, both the services we offer and to the clientele that we serve. We traditionally, and rightfully so, have been known as a welfare office. In fact, if you look all the way back to the mid-90s, I think what you will see is that that was about five times the population of what we have today. Our July 14 numbers are around 178 who actually receive the Work First check or the welfare check. And of those, a very small percentage, about 70, are actually enrolled in our Work First employment program. The others are child-only cases, meaning somebody other than the parent is raising them. So what I want to say today is that basically, as DSS in our community, our focus has changed to having our community be successful and safe. Some things that have not changed, however, is our mission statement. This statement was actually created probably about 14 years ago, and it's as good today as it was then in my eyes, as far as providing opportunities to promote sustained prosperity and independence in our community, enhancing self-reliance by working for the success of our customers and our community, creating an environment where our employees can learn, grow, and be fulfilled, and increasing prevention efforts to protect the most vulnerable and deliver services in a cost-efficient manner. In our eyes, it's one of the keys there, I think, is the one regarding our staff. Every effort that we make is that it's no longer acceptable just for someone to walk in and apply for food stamps. If they need food stamps, then something's going on in their life. Either they're unemployed, underemployed, they have a disability. So we try to trust with our staff that they will look at the whole person and try to figure out what's going on in their life. Is there something that we can give them? The job sheet, we update that every week. Do they need help getting a job? Can we refer them to Goodwill or to another community resource? So basically, what's changed in my eyes is how we look at the service needs of our community to help them be successful. If it's an elderly person coming in, you know, they're paying over $600 a month in medications. They need food stamps, obviously. They may get $30 or $40 worth. But what else can we do? Are they possibly going to benefit from Alamance? So we refer them to Alamance Regional Medical Center to see if there's something that they can do there with Alamance to help them. Or maybe they leave the low-income subsidy program is something that we can refer them to. So all of these areas are areas in which we feel that our staff need to be competent, well-trained, and resourceful. And that's certainly been our vision as we go forth in this new economy. I'll turn it over to Adrian to talk just a little bit about our services.
At DSS, we categorize our work into four distinct areas. So securing basic needs are important for us because what we recognize that if families' basic needs aren't met, then they experience distress. And they're unable to function in areas like at school. Children can't concentrate if they're hungry. The adults of the family may be unemployed. We also recognize that if their basic needs aren't met, it's difficult to function as a household unit. A second area is first responder. So we at DSS are safety responders, much like public safety. 24 hours, 7 days a week, we have staff who are responsible for meeting and responding to reports of child abuse and elderly abuse. Linda's going to talk a little bit about our staff are also responsible for manning Red Cross shelters in times of disaster, and she'll talk a little bit about that. Self-sufficiency is also an area where we work a lot. So there's a perception, as Linda said, that DSS is a welfare office. what we recognize is that we provide services that prepare individuals and families so that they can obtain and maintain employment so that they can become self-sufficient. One of our largest thing that we do is community work. We are a very strong community partner in this area. We recognize that we provide critical services. However, our services that we provide have a greater impact when we combine those with other community resources. And that's what Linda was talking about, is we make those referrals to go along with the services that we provide. So very often you open the newspaper or you turn on the news and you see a story about child welfare, a negative story about child welfare. Sometimes it's a tragic story. Well, recently, Times News contacted our agency and said that they wanted to do a series of articles about the work that's performed by child welfare staff every day. So we were very excited about putting a positive spin on the work that these individuals do every day in our community. This is the first series, this is the first story in that series, so if you missed it in Times News, go back into the archives and take a look at it. It's very positive, very good. This is Gordon Miller, who is a 14-year veteran for our agency, and so we have our share of turnover, of course, but we are very, very privileged to have dedicated, hardworking staff such as Gordon. Oops, did I go too far? Sorry.
We also take very seriously our mandate with regard to disaster services. While that is a small piece of what we do, you get the statistical report, you know, the basic services and programs we offer. This is one that a lot of folks don't know that we have to comply with. We're really happy that back in the March ice storm, you all remember that, when the county basically was shut down for 3 or 4 days, we were called up that morning during the ice and snow to send out staff to man a shelter that was opened at Red Cross in conjunction with County Emergency Management and Red Cross. We also provide general special needs sheltering, not just general public sheltering. When someone comes to work at DSS, on their application as well as in their interview, they are asked, will you be willing to work in a disaster shelter? We get some strange looks sometimes, but we let them know that that is certainly a requirement of their work at DSS. We not only sign them up and put them on a team of one through 12 different teams that we have for disaster services, we also train them. We had over 30 staff who volunteered back in March for the event that we ran the shelter for about 3 or 4 days. I believe it ran from Friday morning through Monday morning. And so again, that is one area that we take very seriously and we will be committed to going forward. In addition, as I said, you receive our monthly statistical report in your packets most every month. These are the main programs and services that we offer, so I'm not going to go through all that. I want to highlight a few. As you may already know, our child support collections this year were over $10.6 million. That is outstanding. That goes beyond the goals that were set for us. That's bringing support back into the county, critical support for children who are in need of that money. We also finalized over 20 adoptions, meaning that these children are now safe and in a stable home. They're no longer in foster care. They have the promise of a family for tomorrow. Another one that's very important, and Adrian has mentioned this, is the adults for whom we serve as guardian. These are incompetent adults, our wards of the state, if you will. Over 78 of them, it varies between 78 and 80 most of the time. These are people who have been declared incompetent in the court of law. On the way here this morning, I actually got a call. An emergency surgical consent was needed for one of these wards. And so we make decisions based on what they need with regard to housing, with regard to medical care, to keep them from being further abused or neglected. And that's something that's only going to grow as we go forward with the aging statistics that we'll talk about in just a minute.
So a little trivia for you. Did you know that in the month of June, there were 2,215 customers that walked through the doors of DSS? It's just 1 month. So because of that, we need lots of manpower. So in the last 4 to 5 years with a sluggish economy, we've had to revamp how we do our work to meet the needs of the increase also, Linda talked about just briefly, we've had a drastic increase in the number of children in foster care. So because of that, we have actually licensed 34 new foster parents within the fiscal year of 13-14. So it's important for us that we actually have families in this community so that our children don't have to go outside this community. We need them to stay close to their families and to the resources here. Also, another trivia for you, Alamance County ranks third in the state of the number of adult care homes, right behind Buncombe County and Wake County. So because of that, our staff, there was actually one social worker added to the adult services unit this year. But we have to have our staff trained and efficient to be able to make bi-monthly contacts in those 57 facilities. There are also three adult daycare centers in Alamance County, and they also have to have regular contact in those facilities as well. Below there, you see that there were 128 legal actions last year that were filed just in child welfare. 36 legal actions filed within adult services. So our legal staff have been very, very busy. We actually have one staff attorney, one contracted child support attorney, and three legal assistants who we keep very, very busy. And sometimes we actually have to recruit our county attorney to assist us in some situations. So our vision, of course, is to partner with individuals and families in achieving prosperity, permanence, and safety. And some of the ways that we have done that and continue to work on that is to measure our performance. Since 2005, we have actually been measuring our performance. Currently, we're working with the county on our performance management program. We have actually implemented lean thinking and government in one area, but we've also implemented the principle in other areas, as we feel that they have led us to be more efficient in our work. We have actually just this year had to realign our executive leadership team so that we could actually become more functional, we could actually adhere to what services we needed to implement. In our work, we're constantly evaluating how we meet the needs of our customers. How do we do it efficiently and effectively? And because of that, we're always looking at, are we doing the right thing? Is there any way that we can change what we're doing to be able to do that better?
Continued challenges. Most of you know we're getting ready to enter into the second year of the Affordable Care Act. Just some general stats. This is the previous year, the one we're finishing up now, we had just over 1,000 applications that came down to us through the federal facilitated marketplace. What that means is when people applied for the Affordable Care Act, they were screened as being potentially Medicaid eligible. So those 1,000 applications came down to us. Of those, more than half were denied as not eligible for Medicaid. Another 268 or so have been approved, and we still actually have some pending. But that presents additional challenges for us. In addition to the Medicaid NC Fast and all the issues that we have going on now, we've also got these affordable care applications coming down. So what we do as we enter into the second year is we take our data from this year, we look at what we had, anticipate what kinds of workforce redesign we may need to do, if any, to accommodate what this second year may hold there. But that certainly will be a challenge for us as we go into the next phase of NC Fast and as we shuffle staff around just to accommodate the volume of customers that we have. Another area that we could not walk out today without talking about, and you all know, is our elderly population. Based on data from the North Carolina Division of Aging and Adult Services and census data as well, at least 71 of the 100 counties in North Carolina are anticipated by the year 2030 to have more over 60 than 0 to 17 year olds. So we have to plan as a community, and that's where you all come in. To work with you all to have a vision for this county, from the year 2000 into next year, 2015, the population of over 60 will have increased from 1.3 million to 1.95 million in North Carolina. We're already feeling this impact locally, thus the volume of our services. Back in 2006-07, we had 30 DSS wards, guardians of the wards of the state. Today, we have 78 to 80. We're seeing more and more elderly adults aging in place without the support of family and without the resources to do so. So as a community, we're going to have to get on working together to have some outcomes and some measurements in place so that we can address these gaps in services. And it's our desire as DSS to be at the table, to sit down with you, to answer any question, to present any data, to do anything that we can do as we talk about elderly. And additional challenges, you know, we've had lots of shifts in funding. We get state and federal funding. We've had lots of shifts in funding. Thus far, we've been able to work around that, but we have no idea what the financial implications will be for the next year or the next year or the next year. So as we plan and strategize with the local, at the local level and the state, we're going to need your support and direction as we do that. Also, to identify other community resources. We are working probably harder than ever, as Adrian said, with our community. I don't know a time in my career, at least, that we've had more partnerships in place, because we cannot do it. We cannot, you know, operate an employment services program entirely on our own. We have to refer them to Alamance Community College, who was here earlier for human resource development, or to Goodwill Industries or other places. We work with nonprofits. That's what we're about. So, again, it'll be a continued challenge to identify these resources in the future. That's just a snapshot. We didn't want to make it all about statistics. You already receive those statistics every month, and we know we need to keep it short based on the agenda that you had today, but we'd love to answer any questions. Do you have any questions?
Any questions?
No, but I'd like to have a comment.
Sure.
One, you guys do a super job. Two, Gordon Miller, mm-hmm. What a wonderful person to feature in your first article. I've had cases with him. He does a mm-hmm. wonderful
Thank
job.
You.
And then last but not least, the Honorable James K. Robertson being present. We appreciate your being here, and he did such a wonderful job in helping with the Family Justice Center and all the other things that he's done to help make your job
Absolutely.
Easier, but also to facilitate the county.
Thank you so much.
Jim, we appreciate it.
We keep him pretty busy in Southwest Airport, too.
Thank you very
Any
much.
Any other questions?
And I do want to say, I think it's important to say we're out of the top 20 with respect to...
Yes.
Absolutely.
The top 20 was not a good thing in regards to the reference that Craig's making to the NC Fast top 20 list. We were identified as a county with high volume, and we were on a top 20 list, but we've dropped way out of that now. So
we're catching up, and we're going through the pending applications and recertifications. And again, they've hired temporary employees. We basically have taken over the training center mm-hmm. Over at DSS, and they've really been committed to getting that number down. And I just want to publicly thank y'all for doing that.
And that's one example of us redesigning the work that we do.
Right.
Thank you, Linda.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, thank you.
County Manager, Mr. Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a memo in your package with respect to a request from the board to look at the portraits of former Superior Court judges at the courthouse. I think we discussed four at the meeting, but we really came up with six. I'm working with Barbara Dotson at the court system. There would be Judge Johnson, who recently retired, Judge Abernathy, who's currently serving, Judge Baylock, Judge Cooper, Judge Lathan, and Judge Smith, and again working with Barbara Dotson as far as needing portraits. And again, we looked at two different options. One was a oil portrait, one was a photographic portrait, and the oil portraits were about $3,500 to $4,000 each, and working on the picture portrait is about $900 each. And that includes frames and pitch or the complete set. So I bring that to you for your consideration.
Any comments, any suggestions from the
yes,
board?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, John.
First off, all of those six individuals are just wonderful judges. Judge Smith, I tried a number of cases before, did a really good job. I think the portraits need to be there, but my major complaint with that is, one, I went back and did some more. I've been practicing law for 42 years. During that length of time, I don't recall a single occasion when the county paid for the portraits. They traditionally were done by the families, by contributions from lawyers and law firms and other individuals. And I just have an issue with the county paying. We're talking about counting the framing and all, what?
$5,400.
Yeah, per times six.
Or $5,400 total.
Right.
Yes.
Times six. So I just don't, I really support the portraits being in the courthouse and all of those judges, particularly Judge Smith, did such a wonderful job, but I hate to set the precedent of the county paying for those. It's just a bad tradition. You're going to have potentially another judge appointed between now and November by the governor for Superior Court, potentially. And then you've got another judge that'll be elected in November. Where does it stop? I don't want to burden the county taxpayers with that burden.
Well, I think the ones that have been mentioned were forgotten by the Bar Association. All of the others were approved by the Bar Association, and for some reason, the six have never been recognized. So that, and I think the Bar Association initiated all of the ones that have been done so far. In speaking of the other judges anyway, and I think they at least need to be there. I have a 35-year portrait that I'll be glad to use if the county doesn't have any money to do it. Do you have the funds to do it, Mr. Manchin?
Yes, sir. There's money and contingency. There's, again, $5,400 will be the total cost for all six.
If you do the photographs instead of the oil paintings.
Yes, sir.
The ones that were just put in the courthouse, one was an oil portrait from many, many years ago, but the others were photographs, and the photographs looked pretty good, I think, on the wall in the courthouse. I went over there and looked at them. I think they look fine.
I wasn't here when this was brought up, but has the Bar Association expressed any concern about, you know, them not doing it as they've done it in the past, or?
I have not heard from the Bar Association.
What is the pleasure of the board?
I'll have to go along with John. I don't think it's the county's responsibility to pay for those portraits, but I'm in favor of hanging the money in there, but I'm just not in favor of supplying the money to do that.
Hearing no motion, the matter is dropped. Alamance County MIS recognition. Frank, are you the one? Who's going to speak for MIS? Oh, I'm sorry. Another judge.
I know nothing about MIS, so.
I don't either.
That's it. The Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, it's again a privilege to appear in front of you. And I appear in front of you with some positive, very positive news as to why we ought to all be very happy to live in Alamance County. As you know, a number of years ago, I got an opportunity to stand in front of you and ask for your support for Family Justice Center. And when you made that commitment, I had the joy several months later to come back and tell you it was up and running and underway. When I made that original pitch, I also outline our vision that we have an opportunity for victims of domestic violence to actually remain safe and secure at the Family Justice Center, and for us to actually conduct hearings and file paperwork without the victim having to leave that safety and security. And then last year, I got an opportunity to let you know that through a collaboration with the state, the Administrative Office of the Courts, and Alamance County, and a host of volunteers and other individuals, some of whom I'll introduce here, it was a reality. It became a reality. We call it the Electronic Protective Order System, EPOS. And it's done everything we hoped it would do. And it really makes those who are the most vulnerable in our community feel safe and feel different about themselves when we conduct this hearing over the video feed and through the computer system. Frank Merrick, director of MIS, submitted that project or program as a to see if it would warrant some recognition with a group called GCN, which is a nationally known, recognized, very prestigious media brand that evaluates and provides lots of information for folks in the MIS world, the IT world. And so he submitted it to see if it could be considered for as a recognition for outstanding information technology achievement in government. Turns out that's a really big deal. I've got a son that lives up in the Washington, D.C. area who works, he's in a private company, but works with folks who have government contracts. And he knows this company, it's this media brand. He understands their newsletter. It's a very important deal, very prestigious. So we thought locally that this was a really good project, you know, but we were slightly biased because this was our baby that we all nurtured, and in an effort to fulfill our promise to you, our vision that we outlined for you when we asked for the Family Justice Center support. It turns out that we're not the only ones who think it was an outstanding program. A national board of distinguished individuals in the field of IT agreed. There were, in addition to Frank Merrick's application to be considered for recognition, there were 150 others from across the nation that were submitted, and this distinguished panel of individuals awarded 3 of these winners, 10 of these winners, just 10 out of the entire nation. And Alamance County, population 155,000, of very good people, won one of those 10. To say that was impressive doesn't do it justice. Other winners included the Navy, Space and Naval Warfare Systems Command, FEMA, the Internal Revenue Service, which, you know, but the United States Air Force Air Mobility Command, the Navy Sea Systems Command, the Kentucky Cabinet for Health and Family Services, California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. That's some high cotton company. In the runners up included the U.S. Army, the runners up behind us. So it's extremely impressive. The company of this award is pretty amazing. The county didn't win this award by accident, however. It took a huge collaboration and a lot of effort on the part of a lot of people. Let me take just 1 second to introduce some of them, just so you'll know they're here. This is Donna Harris with the clerk's office. This is Jill Davis, who's my trial court coordinator over in the court system. This is Lynn Rousseau, who is the director of Family Abuse Services, our family violence advocacy group. This is Cindy Brady, your director of the Family Justice Center. And there's Sherry O'Shields, who has an integral part representing the Sheriff's Department over at the Family Justice Center. All those folks, we meet monthly. We meet regularly. We took what the obligation and responsibility you asked us to take very seriously, and we try to be good stewards of that assignment of responsibility. But I especially, this is an award for MIS, for IT. And so I especially want to recognize and acknowledge two folks here with us today. First is Frank Merrick. Frank, stand up. This is your director, as you know, of the MIS department. And without his leadership and commitment to make it happen so that we had resources and backing from our local MIS to work with the state, this project would have never gotten off the ground. So I thank you, Frank Merrick. Thank you. The other person I want to do a shout out and ask him to stand up. This is Greg Paradis. You may have met Greg, but he works with Frank Merrick's in MIS. And he was the person that put that last piece of the jigsaw puzzle together. He has the gift of being able to take computer ease and change it to common talk and vice versa. He was able to take what we want, what we needed in Alamance County to work, and translate it so that the folks in Raleigh with Administrative Office of the Courts would understand what we were doing and what we needed. And he could take the anxious moments that where we didn't understand at all what they were saying in Raleigh about the development of software program and put us at ease by putting it into language that even a judge can understand. And so Frank Merrick's was kind enough to write a letter to Craig, an email to Craig Honeycutt. This gentleman right here, and this is Frank's own words, he was 80% responsible for making this happen on behalf of your MIS department. Because without him, we wouldn't have this program. So I'd like to thank him. Great hair. Thank you very much, both of you. In sort of wrapping this up, the actual award will be given and presented at an event in McLean, Virginia, on October 14th, and we're hoping to have a group that goes up there and rightfully lets them know that Alamance County is on the map and an important part of the state of North Carolina and the whole nation. We are still the only program of this sort in the entire nation, and we ought to be proud of that. I'll say I'm still in awe of the magnitude and the prestige of this award. And I'm very proud to call Alamance County home. And I thank you for your commitment to the victims of domestic violence, to our community as a whole, to this department, to allow them to help us accomplish a mission, an important mission. And so thank them, and thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge Robinson. We have some budget amendments, AMH grant.
Good morning, Commissioners. Before you is a request for us to budget additional revenue that has been generated from owner fees to remove the abandoned mobile homes in the amount of $1,299.64. This will allow us to remove one additional mobile home.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. Is that new health director here? Yes.
Present.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you all.
We all think it was an excellent selection.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the support and the support of County Admin, Mr. Honeycutt, Mr. Haygood, and all the department heads who showed great support and share their expertise. I am very humbled and honored by it. Thank you. Good morning, and today I get to present to you a request for a budget amendment for the Alamance County Children's Dental Clinic. I am presenting the budget amendment in the amount of $5,000. This is an award, a grant endowment that the North Carolina Dental Health Endowment has bestowed upon the Children's Dental Clinic. And these funds that are awarded will be used to purchase new dental equipment, particularly the hand equipment that they use, and those are the ones that have the drills and the cleaning apparatus. I know, bear with me. That have the drills and the cleaning attachments on those hand pieces. The dental clinic has been using their existing equipment for about 15 years and has only been sending them to get repaired instead of actually getting them replaced as needed. So this funding is very important to the dental clinic, and the funding is from foundation money and therefore does not require a match or any local funds.
Their motion?
So moved.
Their second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Susan, you going to present this one?
Yes, sir. I figure you're here for me enough.
So continuing with our vision, as we do at DSS, and our commitment to the community, and along with the efforts of the Family Justice Center, they've applied for Governor's Crime Commission to continue the Court Navigator Program, which puts a volunteer, kind of like the Guardian Ad Litem Program, a volunteer with our domestic violence victims through the court system. So we have a budget amendment for of $9,354 of additional funds from Governor's Crime Commission that we need to put in that account. We also this year applied for another grant with the Governor's Crime Commission, Legal Assistance Program, that provides some direct funds to help victims with custody issues that go along with domestic violence. And that's $103,100 of state funding from Governor's Crime Commission that we'd like to put in the DSS budget to move forward.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Susan. Tom, you have anything else?
No, sir.
Mr. Manager?
Just a couple of things. Early in this meeting, we did approve under the consent agenda to appoint Libby Hodges as our new county review officer. Libby is now our new planning director. Libby began on August 4th, and we're excited to have her here. She's kind of hit the ground running, but I did want to introduce Libby to you and say she's done a wonderful job to this point.
So welcome, Libby.
She's from Durham County, and we're very lucky to have her. So again, we appreciate the work that Libby is doing. Again, just to reiterate the work of the Family Justice Center, Greg Paravis and Frank and Cindy and everybody, we do want to again thank them. I do also want to mention that the 9th Annual Economic Summit will be held at Elon on October 14th. If you are interested, please see Tori. Again, that is sponsored by the Chamber. And as the board's aware, we do, we're closing the sale of the Peak property, which is the rest home that we recently sold. And that closing right now, for everything that we know, will be closed on September 30th. And also, I do want to thank Ms. Massey. Ms. Massey was also part of the Health Department Board that helped with the interview process for Stacy. And again, I think they did a wonderful job on that hire as well. And that's all I have.
Any commissioner have any comments? Hearing none, is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.